start understanding, hey, what am I good at right now today that people ask me for help with? Mm-hmm. It could be carpentry, it could be money, it could be cooking, gardening, whatever it is.
When we understand debt and how we can position ourselves, we can really put ourselves in a position to make a lot of money.
The reason why we say you should invest in the things that you know, because you need to understand the strategies around this particular investment. So if you're going to the stock markets, then you need to understand how the stock market works.
Because if you cannot afford to buy something twice, then you cannot afford it.
We all have the same 24 hours in a day. What are you doing every single day? What routine are you creating to make sure you're setting yourself up for success? The first point that we want to address is education. We're not wearing these shirts for a coincidence. It is very true that wealth is a mindset. Mm-hmm. So we want to make sure that in order for you to obtain 7, 8, 9 figures, you need to make sure that you have a wealthy mindset, because it doesn't matter how much money you're trying to make, your mindset has to be in check in order for you to obtain the money that you want to make.
Right. And a good example of this would be lottery winners. A lot of lottery winners, they end up going broke because of the mindset they had prior to winning millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. Because the thing is, someone that's poor or broke is going to always be poor until they change their mindset. No matter how much money they make or how much money you throw on it, mm-hmm. people are always going to be who they are. Mm-hmm. Now, someone that doesn't necessarily have a lot of money initially, but has an abundance mindset, it's a little different. Those are the ones that are able to generate multiple millions of dollars because of the way they think.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So not only do we have to get the mindset in check, you also have to have some sort of understanding of what you want to accomplish. Mm-hmm. And for Darius and I, with the education piece, we had to write down the specifics of what we wanted for our lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And that was everything down to the penny as far as how much money we wanted to spend and how we wanted to spend our days. So if you are thinking about this business or this amount of money that you want to make, you have to really be specific in what it is that you want to do so that you can make sure you can drive towards those goals and be in alignment with everything that you want to do.
It's kind of like starting with the end in mind. Totally. What is the lifestyle that you want to have mm-hmm. when you get the funds that you want, and mm-hmm. then what's the plan to get there? Mm-hmm. Now, a plan is really important, or we call it a budget. Mm-hmm. But you know, a plan is really important. Your wealth plan is really important, because before you get to the money that you want to have a plan for it, so you can know exactly where every dollar goes to make sure you get to that end goal that you have in mind.
So not only from a financial standpoint, but understanding from a clarity standpoint, you know, you need to make sure that you understand the full gamut of what this is going to entail for you to accomplish. Because mm-hmm. if your health is lacking, it's not going to be fun being a millionaire if you don't even have the health to maintain the funds that you have.
Right, because you may end up spending all your money on medical bills.
Exactly. So we were talking about first education, getting clarity on what it is that you want for your life and for your lifestyle, and then working that plan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and reverse engineering that plan and going to, what exactly are you good at? How are you going to monetize the information that you have digitally? Now, mm-hmm. digitally is important because this is the age that we're living in. You're able to be in multiple places at once thanks to the digital world that we live in.
Absolutely. So when we talk about the digital standpoint, the reason why we're sharing this with you is because we recognize having digital assets as one of the leanest ways that you can operate and create passive income. Mm-hmm. Because with the digital world, you're able to impact people all over the world who are searching for information.
Right.
Now, one thing to keep in mind is we're not talking about putting you in front of an audience of millions of people. We're talking about the fact that you need to work in a niche market, because there are riches in niches. So if you have a specific skill set or a knowledge base that can be monetized, then you got to get to work.
Right.
And what I mean by that is start understanding, hey, what am I good at right now today that people ask me for help with? Mm-hmm. It could be carpentry, it could be money, it could be cooking, gardening, whatever it is. What is the specific skill set that you possess today that is valuable to the next person? Mm-hmm. And we're not talking about going out and getting any licenses or any certifications, because that's going to take time. We want you to start today. So today, what information can you share with somebody that you know will be helpful for them in their life?
Once we had the idea that we wanted to move forward with, we had to figure out a way to package this information so that we can share it with everyone. Mm-hmm. And the software that really helped us to bring this idea to life was a marketing software called ClickFunnels. Mm-hmm.
And the best part about ClickFunnels is not only is it a marketing software, it's a digital marketing software. Mm-hmm. So it allows us to package all of our knowledge into digital assets that we can share and sell to our audiences. Mm-hmm. So with that, ClickFunnels actually has something called a 30-day challenge. And that's what helped us significantly accelerate our reach so that we could make sure that we were providing as much value as we possibly can. Now, this is not a sponsored video. Let me make that clear. But we want to share this information with you because, like Darius said, we share this information with all of our friends and we want to share it with our subscribers because we recognize that those of you out there who are watching our videos are chasing financial freedom. So let's help you get there even more faster, even more aggressively so that you can understand how to create a business and share your information online with a digital background in place.
So make sure you click on the link below if you're interested in the 30-day challenge. And one thing I would say about a 30-day challenge is the fact that if you aren't surrounding yourself by other successful people, then you need to find successful people to hang around because you are the company you keep. My mm-hmm. grandmother was the first one to tell me that. I know it's a well-known saying, but I want to give her props for that. But you are the company you keep. And if you can't find friends that are uber successful that you want to be like, then the best thing for you to do is read books by successful people. One thing I like about the ClickFunnels challenge is it shares multiple stories of other successful digital creators mm-hmm. and what they would do if they lost everything, how they would recoup those funds in the next 30 days.
Yeah, to start their business all over from scratch. And mm-hmm. so for us, like we said, we needed to do this very quickly. And we took a lot of the stories and the learning opportunities from these individuals and applied that knowledge to our business. Mm-hmm. Now we talked about education, having a plan, and how do we package this so that we can show our information to the world. Mm-hmm. The next part of this, like we talked about earlier, is millionaires are a dime a dozen. So you have to make sure that you have a plan in place that once you start making money, you can keep your money so that you can flip more money and continue to generate more money.
Mm-hmm. Now, the plan that we have for our finances for both our personal and our business is we practice the 50-30-20 rule, which is 20% of everything that we make goes to savings. Yeah, the 30% is flexible expenses, which include things like debt, credit cards, mm-hmm. stuff that isn't necessary, but stuff that we want. Mm-hmm. The other 50% are fixed expenses like our overhead or our mortgage or rent. Things that are really, really important to us that we can't go without.
Yes.
Now, what we're able to do with our understanding of banking is we're able to leverage our savings in a whole life insurance policy and borrow money from ourselves for our business and our personal use. Totally. Now we're able to redirect the other 30% back to ourselves in interest and principal payments so that we're able to keep 50% of our income mm-hmm. in our circle.
Absolutely. So like we said, with this plan that Darius just laid out, that's how we are working through cycling more of our money in our business and our personal lives so that we can continue to generate money. Mm-hmm. Because the name of the game that we always talk about is cash flow. And it's going to be really hard for you to make $1 million if you do not have cash flow.
Yeah.
So let's start talking about that.
Yeah. And at the end of the day, you really want to make sure you live within your means. Mm-hmm. Make sure you live below the amount of money that you make on a monthly or annual basis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And to really bring this all home, everything that we're talking about. So, right, we said you can become a millionaire within 4 years with less than $1,000. That is very aggressive, and that's a very bold statement that we said, but we know that it's possible because we've done it.
Yeah.
We used the ClickFunnels challenge, which was only $100, to understand how to market our business the best that we could. We didn't outsource our marketing because we understand that nobody can speak about our business better than we can. So we had to become the best marketers possible. So that's what you need to do. Whatever knowledge base that you're sitting on, start to understand how to market it. Then put it on a digital platform that will allow you to share that expertise and that knowledge with anyone who is willing to listen mm-hmm. within this niche space, right? So what I'm going to do is put numbers on the screen so that you can reverse engineer the equation that you need in order to create $1 million. So if you want to sell a product to make $1 million, maybe you only need 5 people to buy a specific product for $200,000. Maybe this is a high-end product that you can create. What about needing 100 people to buy something from you for $10,000 or 300 people to buy something for $3,333? And what about 1,000 people to buy a product for $1,000 or 5,000 people to buy a product for $200? Just start thinking about those numbers, because when we understood this, it became so much more manageable and digestible in order to hit the seven-figure mark that we were dreaming of.
Mm-hmm. Now, one thing I really want everyone to really bring home is don't let fear stop you from being successful.
Absolutely.
Do not let fear stop you, because don't underestimate your ability to generate income, because you're already doing it. Mm-hmm. You're already doing it. So don't let fear stop you from being more successful.
And like Darius said earlier, you're going to have a specific knowledge base, but that knowledge base may not translate to your finances. So if you need help in understanding your financial education, how to take things to the next level, then definitely click on the link below and watch our masterclass. We would love to serve you. Mm-hmm. Because like we always talk about, it's about making a buck, keeping a buck, and then flipping that buck, right? So let us help you do that. So now we've given you the blueprint on how to monetize your knowledge, then marry that with a good financial background so that you can learn how to make millions of dollars in the end.
Absolutely. Now, remember, it all starts with an idea. Mm-hmm. What idea do you have? Now, how can you turn that idea into a digital asset, mm-hmm. so that you can sell that asset all over the United States,
exactly.
or the world?
Investing in yourself, mm-hmm. aka education. So for me, the biggest part of education, I think when we got started, is understanding the difference between traditional and non-traditional education.
Right.
So when we think about traditional education, that's where there's a teacher and student relationship, mm-hmm. in the sense of the teacher standing up and the students are listening and observing, versus the non-traditional education is where the student is the problem solver. And what we really feel is that when you start investing in yourself and investing in your own education, you're going to start to gravitate towards the non-traditional or the non-conventional ways of education.
So it's kind of like the school of hard knocks.
Yeah, you could say that. Absolutely. Okay. And the reason why I strongly believe in this is because when we think about traditional education, that's where we are set up for programming.
Yeah. And I think traditional education only takes care of the theory of what you are, you know, getting an education for,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and not the actual application
of it. Yeah, absolutely. And when I say programming, I want to be specific in this, because we have traditional education. We both went to college. I have a master's degree. You know, we went down that road. Mm-hmm. But what we realized very quickly is that set us up for, like I said, programming. It set us up to be a specific type of person, work a specific type of way, consume information a specific type of way. And it kept us, I want to say handicapped in a way, of really getting to our potential, because it kept us boxed in. Mm-hmm. And less comfortable with looking outside of the box and being resourceful in the fact of all of the millions in books that have been created and written all over the world, you know, dibbling and dabbling into that information so that you can then apply was not really taught to us.
Yeah. And I would also go as far as saying that, you know, knowledge is, you know, knowledge is power, mm-hmm. is what is traditionally said, but knowledge is only the potential of power unless you use it. And I think what we get in traditional education is the theory,
mm.
and we get the education, but we don't actually always apply it.
The application of knowledge is power.
Right. And that's where you get that through the school of hard knocks, because you're actually going and you're problem solving, you're trying to figure things out, and you get your understanding through failure, which... Mm. You don't have to go that route, but, you know, failure is the best teacher.
Oh, yeah. And we're taught that failure is a negative, where in this case, failure is actually a positive, because you're consistently learning from, mm-hmm. the trials and errors that life brings upon you.
Yeah. And all that's a part of your personal development, where you can go from to that understanding of, mm-hmm. knowing that, okay, I'm going in this direction. I don't know exactly how I'm going to go about doing that, but I'm going to take what I have around me
and be resourceful
to get me further and further, mm-hmm. Closer to the goals that I want to attain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so the second part of education, so we talked about traditional versus non-traditional education. Now we're going to talk about, once you have applied knowledge at this point, now taking that applied knowledge, boxing it up, and creating a business, mm-hmm. monetizing the education, the knowledge that you're sitting on, because not only are you able to serve others with the information that you currently possess, but in the other piece of it, you're able to take advantage of some tax loopholes by having a business.
Right. And none of this that we're saying right now requires that you have thousands and thousands of dollars.
No, it doesn't. I'm so glad that you said that.
Yeah, because when you think about, you know, what's something you're passionate about, you don't necessarily have to invest monetarily into the understanding of that. What you have to invest is your time.
Oh, very great perspective. Because think about, like, if you're a passionate gardener, you're not necessarily going to go spend thousands of dollars on some certification course, but you're going to read a ton of books. You're going to look up a bunch of articles and blogs and maybe YouTube videos that didn't cost you a bunch of money to figure that out. Yeah. You ever think about that?
Yeah,
like, absolutely. Think about all of the passions that we all got involved in. And then we went and spent a ton of money on some certification when really we could have spent a few hours learning about this particular hobby that we're passionate about.
Yeah, I have a friend now that wants to do real estate investing, and he's so gung-ho on getting his real estate license. I'm like, dude, you don't have to have your real estate license to do real estate investing.
True.
You know, what
go
you,
figure.
You don't need any money to do real estate investing, but what we are taught is the fact that we need to go and pay for some sort of education so that we can get that knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we fell for it, totally.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so the very first point, just to recap that, remember, it's understanding education and investing in yourself. So knowing the difference between traditional versus non-traditional education, and then taking all of that applied knowledge and investing into a business so you can monetize that knowledge that you have.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, the second one that we want to get into, I know you probably knew we were going to say this, but debt.
Yes.
Investing in debt, that's a different way of thinking. Yeah, investing in debt.
What?
What we mean about investing in debt is the fact that the average American, according to debt.org, it has about $38,000 of debt, but the average income is $34,000.
That's fascinating.
So when we talk about debt, the first thing we should be doing is investing in our own debt, because that's where our money is currently going. It's going to debt for most Americans. Not everybody watching this video has debt, but most of us do have debt. So if we can invest in redirecting that debt away from the banks and back to us, then we can put ourselves in a position to where we can, once we understand our own debt, we can go and understand how debt works, period. And put ourselves in a position to take over other people's debt. And when I say take over other people's debt, the example would be, let's say if I give you a loan on a car, I would own the title to that car, but you'll be making payments to me. If you stop making payments, I have the title, which means I have the collateral of the car. I can resell that car.
Yes.
The same thing works with a home. If I'm a real estate investor and I own the home, I have the title, but you're staying there, you're making payments, and you miss a payment, I can foreclose on you and I can redo this.
Start the process all over again.
Start the process all over again. And when we understand debt and how we can position ourselves, we can put really put ourselves in a position to make a lot of money.
Yeah. And what you said, it's just about understanding how the banks work. That's something that we talk about all the time on the Wealth Nation channel, is understanding how the banks work. Because if they're the ones who have all the cash and have all the money, why not duplicate exactly what they're doing, but just on a smaller scale?
Yeah. The secret to success is copying other successful people.
Amen to that. So if anything, what we want you to understand is that to the banks, debt is an asset. But to us as consumers, debt is a liability. So which which side of the equation do you want to be a part of? For us, if the banks have all of the money and they think debt is an asset, then we need to think about that really hard and try to figure out how we can make that work in our favor. And it's all about creating enough cash flow, creating enough money that you can work with, where you can own other people's debts, where you can become your own source of financing, other people's source of financing, your own private bank, because people can then come to you for funding instead of going to the banks. And, you know, again, sometimes when people talk to us, they think that they have to have hundreds of thousands of dollars to make this happen. But think about, you know, credit card balances. The average balance on a credit card, or the average, line of credit on a credit card is maybe $5,000. Mm-hmm. That's not a ton of money. But think of all of the things that people finance on credit cards. You know, it can be laptops, it can be technology pieces, it can be whatever it is. And those are small purchases that can all be financed through your system.
And you can use those items as collateral.
Absolutely. Yeah. So what we want to teach you is about debt. Now let's put this into perspective. The United States of America is $27 trillion in debt. That is a lot of money. Now, where in the world did they get that amount of money from to borrow?
Japan and China.
Now, wouldn't you want to be Japan and China on the receiving end of this massive amount of money? But we're not going to talk politics.
It's different.
But when we think about it, you always want to be on the receiving end when it comes to debt, when it comes to financing, because you were the one who lent out the cash in the first place. You're now turning these loans or these debts into assets for you, and it's liability for the next person.
Yeah, it depends on the position that you want to be in. Do you want to be at the table or do you want to be at the menu?
On the menu.
On the menu. Mm-hmm. Do you want to be at the table or on the menu?
Mm-hmm.
And most of us, we are on the menu because we owe
money.
Bank of America, Wells Fargo, we owe them a ton of money. We actually owe them more money than we actually have.
Mm-hmm.
So we're on the menu.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to position ourselves to be at the table, making the deals, making the opportunities, creating the opportunities for other people so that we can get those interest payments, mm-hmm. so that we can have collateral, mm-hmm. Collateral or first position on items that we can then resell.
Yeah. And like Nelson Nash, who is the author of Becoming Your Own Banker, states what the golden rule is. He who has the gold makes the rules.
Mm-hmm.
He who has the gold makes the rules. Another golden rule for you all. So why don't you want to be the individual who has the gold and can make the rules?
Yeah.
Yeah, I do all day long.
Yeah. And again, we're saying own debt.
Yeah.
Because there's so much of it to own.
Yes.
You know, most people, what they think about debt is they think about the minimum payment so they can get what they want.
Mm-hmm.
They don't think about how much money they pay,
out in interest.
Pay out in interest after that entire debt is paid for.
Mm-hmm.
Or even if they do even pay it off.
Mm-hmm.
So we really have to think about cash flow and the opportunity that debt presents to us.
Yes. I'm so glad that you made that point, because from a consumer standpoint, they think about debt completely different than the person who lent them the money in the first place. So it's important that you take a moment and just think about the opportunities that you have to recover a lot of the money that is leaving your household or your friends and family's household. How many of your friends do you know have a credit card? How many friends do you know own a car, own a house? Could you be the owner of these items, mm-hmm. and collect the interest that is currently leaving those individuals' households?
Yeah, and it may even be better if they're not your friends or your family, because I know some people have a hard time charging their friends and family interest.
Yeah.
But we have an understanding where anytime money is being moved within our family, we want to pay interest because that money stays within our family.
Mm-hmm.
Now, for those of you who do have an issue with it, what you can do is just make sure you have collateral, and the people that you do lend money to, make sure you understand that they are good payers.
Yeah, good stewards of money.
They're good stewards of money, because just think about what the banks do when they give a loan. You have to fill out this 13-page paper about your credit history and, your payment history and all these things so the banks can understand that you can pay their money back. We have to do our same diligence, our same due diligence, so that when we lend our money, we know we're going to get it back plus interest.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
But that's another thing to understand as far as personal development. Don't get into anything that you don't understand fully, because you can end up losing all of your money.
Oh, yeah. Your shoes, your shirts, and your socks. So don't worry. So don't get involved in things that you do not understand. Like we said, going back to tip number one, education. Make sure that you take time to invest in yourself and understand the things that you are getting into. Never give up control of investments or opportunities for you to make money, because nobody is going to care about your money more than you.
And leave us a comment below on what are some things that you invest in where you think you will never have to worry about money again.
Exactly. And also on the Wealth Nation channel, we always talk about creating your own private bank. Mm-hmm. What we just talked about in tip number two. So if this is something that is interesting to you, then definitely click on the link below to watch our masterclass so that we can serve you.
Yep. Now, point number three that we want to make is it's very general, because what we want to say is to invest in something that produces cash flow.
Yes.
Now, for every person, that's different, because we all have different expertise. There's mm-hmm. some people that are amazing with the stock market. There's some people that are amazing with Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. There's some people that are amazing with real estate.
Yes.
There's so many things that you can do to create cash flow for yourself. The most important thing you have to understand is you have to be a specialist in this particular idea or in this particular business.
Mm-hmm. Like I said before, don't give up control of your money. You need to be the specialist. You need to educate yourself so that you can create the cash flow that you need and that you deserve.
Mm-hmm.
So with this tip that we're talking about, tip number three is all about understanding cash flow, taking your money that you would be spending otherwise and putting it in some sort of investment that's going to generate a return. Mm-hmm. Because remember, cash flow is the name of the game. We need liquidity, mm-hmm. which is going to allow us to then take more of that cash flow and invest it into other things that we can create passive income from.
Right.
And understanding passive income is crucial because we're not trading our time for money. Passive income is all about maybe an upfront investment cost or time that we put into something that is going to create reoccurring revenue for us.
Yeah. And there's plenty of educational tools out there for people that want to understand, you know, more specifically what type of investment they should get into or what type of investment is really calling to them, you know, be it Forex trading. If you are a specialist in it, then there's education that exists out there for you.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Now, in addition to being a specialist, I want to keep going back to the passive income piece of things, because the name of the game of this video is so that you never have to work again. And passive income is going to be your best ally in ensuring that you never have to work again. Because if you understand the difference between active and passive income, it's all about making sure that the money is working for you, mm-hmm. and that you aren't working for it. So if you're a specialist, you need to figure out a way to create some sort of asset that is going to allow your money to keep moving for you. Mm-hmm. And the beautiful thing about the world that we live in these days is everything is digital. So are you able to create a digital asset, maybe 1, 2, or 7 digital assets that can sell themselves online so that you don't have to continue to work day in and day out?
Right. Now, let's do this different and think about this in reverse. If you have the passive income, what's going to really deplete your passive income is if you have debt.
Ooh.
Consumer debt. Mm-hmm. Now, the reason why you have consumer debt is because maybe you haven't done your personal development and understand the importance of really understanding debt.
Mm-hmm. Educating yourself.
So if we can do these three things, then we will never have to worry about money again.
Mm-hmm. So I love the fact that Darius worked his way back through the countdown that we just went through and showed you that one can't work without the other, which is why we started in the way in which we did, which is making sure that you invest in yourself with your education, taking it to the next level and monetizing that education by creating a business. Mm-hmm. Second point is all about owning debt, because that's what the banks do. So you need to go out and figure out how you can go start collecting on some debt yourself.
At the bare minimum, own your own debt.
Mm-hmm. Or someone else will, right? That's what we talk about all the time on our channel. And then third is about passive income, creating some sort of asset that's going to generate cash flow for you, mm-hmm. day in and day out. And that's what we really feel is the secret to being able to never having to work again. What I find that people do is there's like way too much in the savings pool and not enough in the investing pool, or vice versa. There's not enough, there's too much investing and not much savings going on. So I think it's important that we have this conversation and just put some action steps in place so that people can really understand how to be aggressive with their money.
Right. So at what point do you stop saving? Well, you never stop saving, yeah. but what you want to do is get yourself to a certain point where you feel comfortable. Either it's 6 months of savings or a year worth of savings. Once you get to that point, make sure you start focusing on cash flow, yeah. focusing on the offense, mm-hmm. because, you know, we talk about infinite banking, and when we talk about infinite banking, we say pay yourself first, pay yourself interest and recapture. Mm-hmm. That's offense and defense. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we're not saying to save your way to $1 million. We're saying that it's going to take both. It's going to take you putting in some effort.
Yes. Yes, some work, absolutely. So if you are new to our channel, Darius and I talk about a concept called infinite banking. And that's primarily where you're going to take your savings and put it into a whole life insurance policy. The reason why we talk about this, the meat and potatoes of all of this, is really because we want our savings to be working for us. Right now, if we keep our money in a savings account, it's going to be earning minimal interest. Mm-hmm. And if we touch the savings, then the compounding effect or the interest that we're earning at the bank starts all over. Well, so when we talk about savings in this instance, it's all about, okay, first and foremost, how can we be as aggressive as possible with our savings? Paying yourself first is a must. So don't misunderstand what we're saying. You mm-hmm. need to save. You need to have the discipline to save. But what we're saying is that's not enough, right? So get the habit, start stacking your money. And then once we start growing those funds, then it's about what are we doing with this money?
And that's all infinite banking is. It's about the action that you take with the savings account that you have on steroids. Mm-hmm. What actions are you taking to make more money? What investments are you making into yourself? What investments are you making into your business? Mm-hmm. What investments are you making into the stock market? Whatever your interest is, what are you doing to create cash flow in your life? Because the cash flow is what's going to take you to that next level of wealth or building wealth.
You know, and for a real talk moment, I think for you and I, once we actually really started paying attention to our finances and then understanding when we come together for our meetings, you know, and understanding where the cash flow is, what we're spending money on, that really turned on a light bulb for me to realize how aggressive we can be with our own financial future. Mm-hmm. Because if you're really passive with your money and you let your money dictate what's happening instead of you dictate what's happening with your money, your finances, then things can just go completely awry. Mm-hmm. So it really was, I would say, a game changer once we started understanding our money, where the money was going, and then also how we can leverage these funds to do more.
Right, because that's another important thing. So when you do come together for your money management meetings, mm-hmm. is the fact that not only do you see where your money is going, you're seeing what is the thing that is allowing you to make the most money.
True.
So when in instances of investments, you want to invest in those things that are making you money so that you can make more money.
Yeah. And then also just having the conversation, because now since we are in the habit of savings, mm-hmm. and in the habit then of moving money to make money, Darius always comes up with off the wall ideas as far as investments and things that we can do. And then I come up with some off the wall ideas, but it's all about a collaboration of the things that we're both into and what we think is going to be the biggest bang for our buck.
Right. So when we think of the map that we want to create for ourselves, of course, the first thing you have is savings. The next thing you have is you want to get involved with maybe something that is going to, not risky, but you want it to be something that you can stomach.
So it's conservative enough, especially if you're just getting started.
Right.
So with investing your money.
Right. So rentals would be good, because everyone needs a house and everyone needs someplace to stay. Mm-hmm. And rentals, I think, are very good mm-hmm. investment to make, but you have to invest in something that you absolutely understand. Rentals is just an example. Whatever your forte is, that's what you should invest in.
Yeah. And the reason why we say you should invest in the things that you know, because you need to understand the strategies around this particular investment. So if you're going to the stock markets, then you need to understand how the stock market works. If you're going into real estate, you need to understand how real estate works. If you're doing Bitcoin, you need to understand how Bitcoin works, mm-hmm. because what you're going to do with the banking concept is you're going to take the money that is growing within your whole life insurance policy and utilize those funds for investments. Some things that Darius and I really enjoy doing is lending, because mm-hmm. for us, we understand lending. That made the most sense to us. Why? Because that's what the banks do. So we were like, if the banks are the ones with all the money, why not do the same thing that they're doing? But we might just be using a few less zeros than they do until we grow it up to their standard.
And we do have about 8 years experience in lending. Yes. So we can say, okay, this is something that we want to do because of the experience that we've gained over the years of us doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And with lending, since we're on the topic, I think it's important that we address it's not as big of an animal as people make it out to seem. I think in our society, or even within families, we're just so used to just giving people money. Oh, somebody needs, you know, $1,000 or $500 here, or $10,000. I'll just write a check and hope that it comes back.
Yeah. And we have bad experiences because we give money to the wrong people. Lend money to the wrong people.
Yes. And with that instance, for us, we're not giving money away. We're just creating a simple contract, a simple agreement with the individuals who are looking for cash, so that we can make sure that we're going to get our money back. Mm-hmm. Because far too often we lend money to family and friends or whomever, and we assume that the money's going to come back. And that's just because we didn't do our due diligence to set ourselves up for success.
And that's the exact same thing we can do with investing. We need to set ourselves up for to make sure the money comes back with his friends.
Go figure. Yeah, because when you invest in any other avenue,
you're doing the same thing.
You're doing the same thing, and you got to make sure that you do your due diligence, because you can't give I can't give my money to Darius and expect that he's going to do something with it. Granted, you can't do that with anybody. So you have to make sure that you are informed, you're in the know, and that you understand what's going on. Because again, that this just happens too much where we see people say, oh, I put my money here and it didn't work out, or it was a bad experience. Well, why was it a bad experience? Because you didn't do the due diligence. And really, if you do have, for whatever reason, a situation that comes up that doesn't pan out, at least you can learn from it and say, hey, you know what? I messed up here. I didn't have this correct contract. I didn't have the right exit strategy. Whatever the case may be, you can learn from it. That way on the next investment, you can do better.
Right. And this is exactly, this is how I can do better the next time. So I can gain that experience. Now, one thing I also want to talk about is 401ks and IRAs, or your investment accounts within your jobs. There's nothing wrong with putting money inside of your 401k. I think a 401k is good for individuals who would otherwise go to retire and not have any money. For those individuals who aren't disciplined to do something with their money, put it into a 401k so you can make sure that you at least have the minimum of whatever the requirements are at the time of this video is published. You make sure you at least have that to take care of yourself.
Bare minimum.
Bare minimum when you retire. Because the thing about 401ks is we're limited to how much money we can put into it on a annual basis. And the amount of money that we're able to put into it isn't enough to take care of us throughout our entire retirement phase. Because, you know, people are living out a lot longer, people are healthier, and there's a good chance or possibility that we could outlive our money. Now, the way we get past that is we have to do something else in regards to the cash flow that we create for our retirement. We can't just rely on retirement accounts. We have to do something. We have to take action. And that's what infinite banking is all about. This isn't life insurance that you just put money into and then 10 years later you look at it and you have
set
it and forget it. This is not infinite banking. That's life insurance if you're going to buy a life insurance policy and not use it. Infinite banking is about the action that you're taking to invest your money, the action that you're taking to invest in your business and create cash flow. That's what infinite banking is all about.
Yeah, and segue to that, if you are interested in learning about infinite banking and or becoming our client, then definitely click on the link below to join our community. We would love to serve you so that you can do the same. Now, the point that you said, to invest in retirement accounts at the bare minimum. I hear what you're saying. I hear what you're saying. So, when you said that, it made like a hair on the back of my neck stand up. But the reason being is because I totally understand that there's going to be a general population of individuals who care absolutely 0% of doing anything with their money. They're just going to put it up and
set it and forget it.
So we're talking to those individuals. If you have absolutely no desire to do anything further with your money, then yeah, do a 401k. However, that is never our recommendation for those of you who are trying to do something with your lives, who are trying to do something with your financial opportunities, with your financial goals. Because when you put your money inside of 401k, you lose complete control over it. And again, like we just said before, the only way that you can create financial freedom or create wealth for yourself is you got to get involved. You got to roll your sleeves up and you got to have the discipline in place and take action. These retirement accounts, again, are only for the individuals who really care less.
Who would otherwise not have any money in the future. That's what I said.
Yeah, exactly. So with that instance, so again, the title of this video is Stop Saving Money. So again, don't misunderstand what we're saying. We're saying save money, but that's not it. That's not
going to build wealth.
That's not going to be the ticket. The discipline in place is about saving money. And then the next step, that's what we keep missing, is that next step and what it is that we're going to do that's really going to build wealth.
Yeah, we need to generate income. We need to generate cash flow. We need to generate passive income.
Yes.
This is what is going to help us build wealth.
Yes.
When you talk about building anything, there's action that's required. Building is a action word. So it takes action in order for us to get there.
Yeah, totally. So when you were talking about the action, that made me think about everything that we have going on within our finances and banking. You're just saying verbs, you know, we're talking about action words. So a lot of times people contact us and they say, hey, Carmen and Darius, when can I stop paying my policy? Or hey, Carmen and Darius, when can I stop creating cash flow? And my question to you is, when do you want to stop making money? because that would be the answer. Yeah. Whenever you want to stop making money is when you stop putting deposits into your bank system. When you stop creating income, that's when you stop earning income. Mm. So when we think about the banks are open 7 days a week.
Yeah, right? Because we're spending money every single day.
They're open 7 days a week, so you need to be open 7 days a week and 24/7, if anything, because, again, banking is something that's constantly happening. So when you're thinking about these policies that are being created or the cash flow that's being generated, you should be having a vehicle where you can keep that money flowing constantly, and there isn't just a set time frame where everything just shuts off.
Yeah.
Because banking happens every single day.
Now, wait, the banks are open on Sundays, and they close early on Saturday.
They make enough money where they can be closed on Sunday. Okay?
But when you put your debit card in your credit card,
that's what I mean. It still works, right? That the offices might be closed, but that ATM machine, that thing keeps reeling money out, right?
Yeah, and exactly what the banks have been able to do is build a system mm-hmm. in which they're able to make money 7 days a week, even when they're not open on Sundays and half the day on Saturday. Mm-hmm. We need to have that same thinking mm-hmm. when it comes to how we build wealth. Let's think of the successful people that we see, like the Jeff Bezos.
Oh yeah.
Like the Warren Buffetts.
Yeah.
Like the Bill Gates. They're still taking action and making money. Yes, they have multiple billions of dollars, but they're not just sitting there and not doing anything. Mm-mm. They have systems in place. They have people in place that allows them to continue to make money. Mm-hmm. And we needed to do the exact same thing, just on our own scale.
Exactly. So your next question would be, Carmen and Darius, okay, you keep talking about we need to take action. Where do we put our money? So let's think about opportunities that you have to put money in. And we mentioned some of them. We said real estate. We said the stock market. You can do equipment financing. You can do technology packages. You can do lending, like we talked about. Mm-hmm. You can become your own private lender. There's so many opportunities for you to make a buck. Bitcoin, we didn't even talk about that. That's always a popular one. Gold and silver, that's a popular one. But again, you have to make sure that the money is staying in motion.
Yeah, let's think about where you work every single day. How's the company that you work for investing their money to make more money? Well, they're investing in you. You are an investment to that company. Yeah. So when it comes to cash and what we can invest in, there's no limit. The only limit we have is the limits that we put on ourselves, or the only limits that we have is, you know, when we look into the mirror, what are we telling ourselves that our capabilities are? What are we telling ourselves that our capabilities aren't? Mm-hmm. Those are our limits right there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the other thing too, is many of you may be thinking, hey, you know what? I don't have a ton of cash to get started, because that could be something that's intimidating. When you want to invest, I feel like a lot of people don't invest, one, because they don't have the knowledge, two, they don't have the cash, and or three, it's just fear. Mm-hmm. Maybe a combination of all of it.
Yeah.
So you have to understand that when you start investing, you need to just start small so that you can get your feet wet, you can get comfortable, and then you can start getting confident within this whole process and how it works.
Yeah, because let's say you don't have any money to invest, do you have enough money to buy a book? To invest your time in learning a new skill?
Yes, yes, yes.
That's all investments. Mm-hmm.
All right, so Darius and Carmen, you keep talking about investing. How do I get started? What do I do? So I'm going to give you an example of a lending opportunity that maybe you can do yourself. This is what Darius and I know. This is our realm. So let's break the numbers down, okay? So let's say, for example, you have an opportunity to lend money to an individual who needs $1,000. And in this instance, this individual is trying to buy, what's something that you can buy for $1,000?
A new cell phone.
There you go. That's a good one. Cell phones come out all the time. So this individual wants to buy a new cell phone. You're going to help them buy it outright so that they're not paying Verizon monthly payments. Mm-hmm. You're just like, you know what? I'll pay it. You pay me instead of paying Verizon. That happens a lot. You can do that with family.
Yeah.
So in this instance, $1,000 for the cell phone. And let's say you give them 8 months to pay it back. 8 months. So in this instance, what we're going to do is we're just going to create some specific terms. We're going to charge this individual 10%. And for 8 months, they're going to pay us, let's do 12%. Let's up the ante a little bit. 12%, they're going to pay $120 for 8 months. That's a 10% return that you just got within an eight-month time frame. So not only did you save $1,000, you then took that $1,000 and made 12% over an eight-month time frame. So you made $120. That might not seem like a lot up front, but you just did that within 8 months and your money was just sitting.
Right. That's more than what you can do inside of your savings account because of the fact that you took action.
Exactly. So how many times do you want to do that? How many times can you flip money to make money? And that's what we're talking about is the interest. The interest is really the secret sauce in all of this. Whatever investment that you put your money into, you got to be making some sort of return because the interest is really what's going to bring all of the principal and that interest back home to you so that you have more money to continue to turn.
Right. And even if you're are well-versed in the stock market, you can start off small and build your way up to where you're investing or have a ton of money in there to invest. It all starts with starting.
Yes.
If it's $100 that you want to invest in the stock market and you understand it, then the next time you get paid, you invest another $100, another $100, another $100. And the compounding of the money that you're able to make within those investments, that allows you to make more money.
Exactly. And the other piece of this too, so with the investing, with lending specifically, with lending, you need to make sure that you have collateral, meaning that you have a guaranteed payback. So if you are giving $1,000, you need to make sure that you have something of that individual's, something that they own in your possession so that in the case that they default, then you're able to have that guaranteed payback.
Right.
And in that case, it would be the cell phone because you're the owner of the cell phone until they pay you back.
Right, but make sure your collateral is worth more than the amount of cash that you have lent to them because you want to build incentive for them to pay you back. Mm-hmm. Now, this is just an example that we're giving you because this is what Carmen and I do. We lend money. But in your example, take a look at your abilities and the inventory. Do an inventory of what you are able to do. What you specialize in and get books, invest in books, invest in education, invest in courses so that you can grow that knowledge into your own personal business.
Absolutely.
Carmen just gave you an example of a $1,000 loan that we did in the past. Here's an example of a real estate deal that we've done when we're investing in real estate. We borrowed $10,000 from a private money lender at 8% for 1 year.
Now, private money lender may sound fancy, but it's really it's somebody who had $10,000.
Right.
And their name is not disclosed.
Right, and they wanted to get involved with real estate without
getting involved
in real estate, so they gave us the money. So what we did is we had another investor, real estate investor, that needed funds. So what we did is we lent the money that we got for $10,000 for 1 year to a real estate investor for 6 months at 10%. And we did this twice. Mm-hmm. So we were able to earn 20% in 1 year from the real estate deal. And then we only had to give the investor back 8% after 1 year.
Because that was the agreement they had with them.
Right. So the difference is the fact that we were able to earn 12% interest without having to bring any money to the table. Mm. And when you understand how to lend money and invest money with whatever your specialty is, then you can create similar opportunities where you don't even need money to get started.
Yeah, it's true. Because all you need to do is cover your butt and make sure that you're making more interest than what it's costing you for the money to be out.
Exactly. So where there's individuals who don't want to take action, there's people who will take action on their behalf and they end up making more money than the person that actually had the money.
Yeah, because they're the ones moving it.
Right.
Which is where you all need to be, ladies and gentlemen. So go ahead and comment below and let us know what are the ways that you have moved money to make money. And these are nuggets that we're sharing with you because one thing to consider is, like I was saying, a lot of people don't get involved with investing because they don't have the money. When we first got started, we didn't have the money either. We had to grow our own system. And so what Darius just shared with you, that example, was us being the middleman. We knew individuals who had money, those individuals who had money in their 401ks that didn't want to do anything with their money. And we just created a deal with them and said, hey, we can get you 8%. That's more than what you're making in your current retirement account. So let's do some business together. Mm-hmm. And then all we did was take that money and then lend it out to another individual at a higher interest rate. And at the end of the day, we are solving problems. For both people. Because one party wants to make more interest and one party needs money to make a transaction. So we're able to come together and create solutions for everyone.
Right. So we gave you that example because we don't want you to let not having money limit you to what you're able to do for yourself in creating opportunities.
So glad you said that.
It doesn't take money to make money. It takes
creativity
to make money.
It takes hustle, it takes drive, it takes hunger, all of that, because there are so many opportunities that you can get involved. I mean, think about, you're watching us on YouTube. It is free 99 to start a YouTube account, and all you need these days, you probably have a cell phone and you can start creating passive income by creating videos that are solving problems for everybody out there. There's so many ways that you can get involved in making money. You just got to get ready to get started.
Every time we went to lunch with a millionaire, we started to notice exactly what they were ordering. A lot of times they ordered water, and then other times whenever they get an appetizer, they don't always order a dessert also. So we started to notice a few things like that.
Yeah, because on the contrary, we order everything and a few drinks, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Now, another thing that I noticed is that every millionaire that I knew had something that they kind of spent money on and other things they could care less about. So for example, if they enjoyed watches, then they could care less about their cars or the kind of clothes that they wear.
Yeah.
And another guy that I knew, if he enjoyed his cars, then he looked basically like a bum. Now, just to add to that, there's another gentleman that I knew that had a really nice house, but he drove a Toyota Camry.
Mm-hmm.
And it was an old Toyota Camry at that.
Mm-hmm.
So every single millionaire had a thing that they really enjoyed, but one thing they had in common was they all had good financial habits.
Yes.
And some of those habits we should start taking on ourselves so that we can start having money like they do.
All right, so the very first point that we want to address with you is do not spend money to impress your neighbors, to impress other people, because that's where we get into trouble. That's where we just start overspending and spending money that we don't have because we're trying to look good for someone else. At the end of the day, we spend so much time trying to look like money, but we ain't got any money to begin with. So definitely take this into consideration the next time you try to make a purchase. When you buy shoes, when you buy your house, when you buy your car, whatever the case may be, why are you buying this? Are you buying it because you need it, or are you buying something more expensive because you're trying to look good for someone else?
And at the end of the day, you pay your bills, not them.
Yep.
But until they start contributing to the cause, then who cares what in the world people think?
Exactly. Now, if you answered yes to this, or you know that this is you, then do me a favor and click on the link below and join our currency crash course. And the reason being is because we are here to help you bridge the gap between where you are financially to where you want to be so that you can live the lifestyle that you deserve and stop living for somebody else.
The second thing that I noticed is never make a large purchase that you have to buy immediately. Always sleep on it. Because if we're pushed into making a purchase immediately, we're going to make an emotional decision.
Oh, yeah.
We don't want to make emotional decisions. We want to make logical decisions. And if we're able to go home and think about it, then we can start tapping into that more logical way of looking at things.
Mm-hmm. And I know that I've done this before, is sometimes I might feel obligated or pressured to make a decision. Man, you are nodding your head a little too hard over there. So basically, what I was trying to say is I felt pressured to make a decision, and I realized that I just needed to take a moment and clear my head and think for myself instead of feeling pressured about something. So the whole point of taking a moment, taking a break, and walking away is just to give you the clarity that you need to really make an educated decision, because if not, it's going to be an emotional decision and you may end up regretting it later. Now, this leads us to the third point, which is never buy something that you cannot afford. More specifically, stop using credit for your purchases. Now, why in the world are you buying things that you cannot afford? If you're dependent on credit cards or loans or whatever the case may be, your mama, your daddy, to pay for these things, you are not doing well financially. And you need to take a moment, look in the mirror, you know, speak to yourself and come to terms with where you are. And the other point that I want to make with this is if you cannot afford to buy something twice, then you cannot afford it. I mean, if you're shopping for a car, if you cannot afford to buy that car two times, then you cannot afford it. The shoes, the stuff for our houses, anything, our house in general, if you can't buy that sucker twice, then you cannot afford it. So this is a really nice measure that we like to use to understand whether or not we can afford this purchase or not.
Now, we're not saying that anything's wrong with credit, because
yeah,
there's a difference between needing credit and wanting to use credit as a way of leverage. There's
yeah,
two different ways to go about doing this.
Yes.
If you need it, then there's a problem.
Yes.
The problem is you can't afford it.
Yes.
If you want to use it to leverage yourself and put yourself in a position where you can use this to invest or use this to make money in other places, then by all means.
Put yourself in a better position.
Exactly.
Then yes. This is the credit that we're not talking about. We're talking about dependency on credit.
Right. At the end of the day, our habits are what make us who we are.
If me and you had the same amount of income, but one of us had better financial habits than the other, the person with the best financial habits will always end up with the most money.
Say that one more time. I think people really need to get that.
If both of us had the same amount of income and one of us had better financial habits than the other, the person with the better financial habits will always end up with the most money. And we talk about this more in our course in the section, Where Are You Now? Because it is very important that you maintain the habits of successful people so that you can be successful. Your habits are what makes you who you are. Exactly. And the better financial habits that you have, the better your finances will be in the future.
So definitely click on the link below so that you can start creating a lifestyle that you deserve.
Right, change your health, change your wealth. Now, the next thing that we want to talk about is the fact that rich people have budgets. All the millionaires that I talked to had budgets and they knew their numbers to a T. They were well calculated when it came to their personal expenses and their business expenses, because every financial decision that you make, no matter how big or how small, affects your bottom line. Mm-hmm. And whenever it came to making these decisions, they were very, very well calculated.
Exactly. I mean, to the point where they're just rattling off numbers as if you would think that they're reading a spreadsheet, but they're not. We're just in normal conversation. So are you able to do the same thing with your numbers? Can you just rattle off how much your expenses are, or do you actually have to look it up? If you have to look it up, then maybe you're not as in touch with your finances as you think you are. And that's why we always talk about creating a plan or a budget, whatever you want to call it. We're not trying to restrict you from your spending. We're trying to get you to be more aware of your spending. That's the difference in the plan that we want you to create for yourself.
Right. And don't get us wrong. Money isn't everything, but it is most things, because most things require us to spend money in order to attain them. Mm-hmm. Some of the things that we want to accomplished as far as our lifestyle, it requires money for us to exchange that for our time back.
Absolutely.
So money is a very important thing, but it's not everything.
And if everything is affected by money, you need to be able to understand how to manage it. That's the one thing that I feel in life that we're so ill-equipped on, is we don't understand how to manage our money, but yet our money affects everything that we do. So since we spent all this time talking about being aware of your finances, the fifth thing that we want to share with you is always get the best price. Just because you spend $200 on a pair of shoes doesn't make them more comfortable. It means you spent $200. So if anything, do your research, understand the value of the things that you're buying, and make sure that you're always getting the best price. And it's so easy to do so these days with Google, with Amazon, and all the resources that we have at our fingertips. There's no reason why you shouldn't be able to do your research.
Right, and I can take this back to a time where I remember going shopping at Costco for shirts because they were on sale. It wasn't for me, it was with one of the friends that we were with. They were multimillionaires and they had to go to Costco to purchase these bamboo material shirts. And the reason that it kind of took me back was, here I am thinking I'm getting a good deal by going to the Polo outlet, but then this guy is going to Costco to get shirts and getting super excited the fact that they're on sale at Costco. So it made me definitely start to reevaluate some of the things that I spend my money on and really start thinking about making sure I get the best price.
And also it makes you think about the value that we place on things, because I know Darius, my fashionista, he really appreciates clothes. And so having that shopping experience at Costco definitely changed his perspective on the value that we place on certain things.
The $100,000 per year that I'm talking about is the one where you net $100,000 per year doing something that you really enjoy, like a business. Mm-hmm. And the reason why we want to talk specifically about a business is because I know for myself, in my career as an engineer, I earned $100,000, but that was $100,000 gross that I wasn't able to bring home. Mm-hmm. I had to pay taxes. I had to pay expenses, mm-hmm, and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. So what I was able to bring home wasn't quite the $100,000 that I was thinking.
True.
So we have to understand, first of all, the difference between gross $100,000 and net $100,000.
Exactly. So let's break that down really quick so that we're all on the same page. When we say gross, exactly to Darius's point, that's the amount of money that the company that he worked for said that they would pay him. What we didn't take into consideration was taxes, our home expenses, and any other expense that came through the door. And then what we were left with was a lot less than $100,000. Let's just say that.
Yeah. A lot less than $100,000. Now, the reason why we bring this up is because it's really important for us to be specific about what we want. Yeah. Because we can say we can earn $100,000 this year, and we can go and win the lottery and have $100,000.
Yeah, yeah.
But after taxes, you're left with a lot less. So in our plan to create this nice round number of $100,000 annually, we have to be specific about what we want. Mm-hmm. Do we want to gross $100,000? Do we want to net $100,000? Do we want to earn $8,333 per month? Or do we just want it in one big $100,000 check?
Yeah. However it comes, I think that the plan today is, again, just making sure that you understand what this entails, how we go about this, because we know that everyone on the Honor Channel who subscribes wants to achieve some level of financial freedom. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be different for everyone. $100,000 in New York or LA may not be cutting it. $100,000 in South Carolina, where Darius is from, may be fitting the bill. So we just have to take into consideration inflation, geography, and all the other expenses that you inquire or take in every single month, and then, you know, do the numbers to figure out what that means for you.
Right.
So why don't we get started with a breakdown?
Yeah, let's do it. So $100,000 over 12 months is $8,333.33 monthly.
Yeah.
Quarterly, it's about $25,000. Mm-hmm. On a weekly basis, is about a little over $1,900.
Correct.
And on a daily basis, it's $274 and some change. Yeah. That's around the $275.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So when we think about what type of product or service we want to offer to get this $100,000, we have to think about how do we want to fulfill, what's the fulfillment going to be?
Mm-hmm.
So that we can attach our plan to that. Mm-hmm. Because without a plan, you just have a goal of $100,000. It means nothing.
Yeah.
A lot of people have goals to be financially free. Mm-hmm. A lot of people have goals to be debt free.
Mm-hmm.
But what we have to do is set a plan for that. Mm-hmm. And the plan is to, first of all, start with a number that you can reach for.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So when I want to make sure that we capture all of those nuggets that you just shared with us, because when we think about $100,000, people get overwhelmed with that amount of money. They think about, oh my God, what can I sell? What do I have a value? What can I do to reach that number? Which is why Darius broke down how much it's going to cost you on a quarterly, monthly, and a daily basis. Mm-hmm. So that's why we want to make sure that you're just focusing day to day. You know, what can I do day to day to start making this amount of money? So we said $275 a day, 7 days a week. That's what you need to strive for. That's what you need to commit to in order for you to have this business that's going to sell products and services for you so you can reach that goal. So break that down even further. If you know that every single day you need to make $275, are you selling something one time for $275? Are you selling, you know, two products that add up to $175? Are you selling 10 products that will then add up to $275? What can you fulfill on?
Mm-hmm.
So the fulfillment is the biggest thing that I feel like we never really took into consideration with building our businesses, is what can we realistically fulfill on? And that means if we're selling something, you know, something one time every single day, are you going to burn out? Is this something consistent that you can do? So you need to have an honest conversation with yourself and figure out, I would say, what is the most passive thing that you can do where you can build something maybe one time, spend, you know, a month, 2 months, 3 months, whatever it is, building this thing, and then let it run autopilot.
Mm-hmm.
So in the digital world that we live in, we totally feel like this is very possible, especially with YouTube and Instagram and all this, the social media platforms out there. So when we think about, okay, what can I sell? I want you to think about the knowledge that you possess. What is the one thing that people continue to ask you? Hey, Darius, can you help me with this? Hey, Darius, what do you think about this? What is the one thing that people continue to ask you the same thing about?
Yeah. And then maybe people don't ask you anything. What is something that you're good at? Maybe you're good at investing in the stock market. So that means you need to have a little money up front so that you can hit it big. Let's say you have $10,000, you invest your money in the stock market, and then 12 months later, you have $100,000.
Mm-hmm.
You're amazing at investing in the stock market.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's your thing. Mm-hmm. Maybe you're good at doing something else. Maybe you're good at marketing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a ton of people out there that has businesses that need services as far as marketing. Maybe you're good at that.
Yeah, taking pictures, whatever it is.
Whatever it is.
Yeah. So with that, what we're saying, what we're trying to give you, we're trying to give you ideas. So if you are a photographer, if you're a good marketer, if you're a good cook, You know, what are the things in today's day that you can package and resell over and over again? Mm-hmm. So let's say you're a good cook. You know, let's just run with this. If you're a good cook and someone continues to ask you for your lasagna recipe or your spaghetti recipe or your juicing recipe, can you create a digital book that is filled with all of your most popular recipes and sell it? Mm-hmm. You can totally sell that for $10. Yeah, right? There's a ton of value in that. If you are a marketer, can you put down like the top 10 steps that you need to do to be great on Instagram? Can you package that in a nice PDF that's visually appealing that you could then sell and repackage time and time again? Do you see what we're getting at here? Well, we're not talking about going out and trying to flip cars or flipping houses, because that's going to take some time for you to figure out and work through those kinks.
Yeah.
What we're saying is monetize the knowledge that you are currently sitting on.
Absolutely. Now, the really important thing we also want you to get from this is the fact that if $100,000 is overwhelming, then drill it down to, or melt it down to, a number that's more realistic for you. And then if $27 is more realistic for you to create a product around $27, then start there.
Yeah.
Because you have an entire year in this plan to get to $100,000. You don't have to do it overnight. Mm-hmm. So start where it's something that you're comfortable with, a number that you're comfortable with, mm-hmm. and then start working from there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the other thing, I don't know if you all caught this, but we're not telling you to go out and buy a ton of inventory.
No.
Right? We're not telling you to go spend money. We're just saying take a few moments and package something together on your computer that the next person will find valuable. Or, you know, package something that you currently have on in your house that the next person will find valuable. A lot of times what I feel when people get started in business is they get out a business loan, they go get $20,000, $50,000 in a business loan, and now they're sitting on debt that they can't move. Or they buy a ton of inventory that they're not sure that they can even push or move, mm-hmm. right? That's where a lot of business owners get stuck, is they invest in these businesses. I know we did this with network marketing. We invested in a ton of capital and then we couldn't move, or excuse me, we invested in a ton of product and we couldn't move it because we weren't really in the game. You know what right. I'm saying? So be honest with yourself. That's why I'm saying we really need to figure out our knowledge. Our knowledge is up here. So how can we transfer that onto a piece of paper, a digital piece of paper, and sell that online so that we can reach as many people as possible?
Yeah, everything that we have was created by someone. Mm-hmm. Every single thing, this camera, the laptop, this table,
yeah,
you know, my watch, mm-hmm. everything was created by someone. Mm-hmm. So they had the same, you know, 24 hours in a day. They had the same five fingers and two hands. They had the same brain. They just used the tools that they had around them differently.
Yeah.
So we all have the ability in us. We all have the wherewithal to create it. Mm-hmm. We just have to actually do it. Mm-hmm. And the most important thing for us to understand when it comes to generating income is it's a result of what we create. It's a result of the actions that we take. It's a result of the products that we create. Mm-hmm. So we have to make sure that we, again, drill this thing down to something that we personally can understand.
Yes.
Maybe you understand how to do something for $1,000. Mm-hmm. That means you only have to do that a few more times to get to $100,000. Mm-hmm. So drill it down to something that we're comfortable with.
Yeah, and to bring some perspective to this from our personal journey, right? So our business, we are life insurance agents, and we had no idea that there were millions of people in the world that need information when it comes to life insurance. And if you're looking for information about whole life insurance, then click the link below. We would love you to join the Wealth Nation. You like how I set that up? So anyways, what I really mean by that genuinely saying is we had no idea that if we just shared information, free information about life insurance, that people would then come back to us and ask more questions and want policies, mm-hmm. or want to move forward or want us to help them figure out how to maximize their efforts when it comes to life insurance. Mm-hmm. And all it took was us putting free information out there. And next thing you know, we have a profitable business because we're able to share the knowledge that we possess.
Yeah, it started with something that we liked, and then somebody asked us about it. So we figured, we might as well start telling people about it.
Yeah, exactly. And YouTube, a free platform, is what allowed us to spread the knowledge. So the next thing that you may be saying is, hey, Carmen and Darius, how am I going to, get my name out there? So again, there are so many free opportunities that you can maximize, you know, with the platforms that we have. So Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, you know, TikTok, whatever it is, start understanding those platforms. There's all sorts of courses and tutorials and free information out there that you can get a handle on all of these platforms so you know how to set yourself up appropriately.
Yeah, and the same thing when it comes to $100,000. Don't worry about getting your name out there. Worry about what you can do in every single day to move the needle forward just a little. Mm-hmm. Because that's really important, because if you don't have that foundation, then you can't get to the next step anyway if you haven't completed step one. Mm. So make sure you do what's important in the first day, and then move on to the second day, the third day, because getting your name out there is, you know, can be overwhelming. So don't worry about it. Worry about what you can do today.
That the ego can get in the way, right? You know, my name and branding and business cards and my website and all sorts of stuff. You don't need any of that. I can't tell you how much money Darius and I actually made without needing a website.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it's enthralling how much we focus on the things that just really don't matter. Mm-hmm. One thing that I want to address with you is, Darius said, what are you doing every single day to move the needle forward? Let's talk about that. Because when we started our business, I know the biggest thing was, is every day you may not see that money rolling in how you expected it to happen, but you need to make sure that every day you are doing a revenue generating activity.
RGAs is super important.
Revenue generating activity, meaning what are you doing to get a sale? What are you doing to get closer to a sale? And don't be discouraged if you don't see the sales rolling in immediately. Mm-hmm. Like you said earlier, it's all about, we all have the same 24 hours in a day. What are you doing every single day? What routine are you creating to make sure you're setting yourself up for success? Because it's going to take time. It's going to take time to build this. Let's be realistic. It's not going to start tomorrow, but what are you doing? You're building a foundation of a revenue generating business that's going to start cash flowing for you, but it's just going to take some time in order for this to happen.
Absolutely. So for example, Carmen and I have a routine. We wake up in the morning, we exercise, we get our baby ready, we hang out for a little while, and then we come to work. And the way we come to work is we have a tool called Asana, in which we put all of the things that need to happen in that day to move the needle forward. We get as many of those things done as we possibly can. And at the end of the day, if we can knock off at least four of those things, then we've had a successful day.
Yeah.
That's how you move the needle forward, where you have a plan and you have tasks associated with helping you get towards those specific milestones that connect to your ultimate goal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm glad that you mentioned Asana, because for us, that's how we organize our thoughts and our plans and our goals. It's a free tool that you can use, totally not sponsored. It's just something that we value. So with that being in mind, you know, revenue generating activities, are you making the right relationships? Are you setting up the products that you need? Do you have the materials that you need? Do you have the graphic designers? Do you have the video editors? Do you have whatever it is set up so that you can continue to make sure that this snowball is moving forward? That's what we want to hone in on. This is the other thing that I feel is, you know, people just set it up to make it unrealistic, where all of a sudden you're just going to be, a thousandaire, 100,000aire overnight, and you didn't do anything in order for that to happen. The difference maker that's going to set you up is what you do daily. The difference maker that's going to set you up is what you do daily. Not what do you do sometimes, what do you do quarterly, what do you do every single day that's going to move you closer and closer towards that goal.
Yes, and 100%, you do not need to overwhelm yourself with websites and marketing and things of that nature until after you earn your first $100,000. After you earn your first $100,000, that's when you need to think about hiring someone or outsourcing so that you can, you know, earn, add another zero to it and add $1 million. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So really the most important thing is to take the little bite that you can swallow right now and actually move forward on that. Mm-hmm. Move forward on a $27 product. Mm-hmm. Move forward on a $275 product. Mm-hmm. Move forward on a $1,000 product that you can offer. Mm-hmm. Don't Set the goal for $100,000, but then have milestones that help you get there and tasks associated with each one of those milestones.
Absolutely. So bite-sized chunks. You cannot eat an elephant all at once. You can only do it one bite at a time. So right now, I want you to start writing down ideas as far as what is it that you can sell of value for those price points that Darius just mentioned. Mm-hmm. And don't underestimate your value. Like we said, who is asking you the same, or who? What are the questions that you get all the time? You know, Darius, how do you do this? Carmen, how do you do this? Look at this, check this out. Those are things that people value. So if one person values that from you, then there's gonna be millions of other people that value the same thing. They just haven't found you yet. So you need to make sure that you create a product that is then gonna be searchable online for people to find you, for you to become discoverable, and that for them to be able to break bread with you, because now you're exchanging value.
Mm-hmm. Value is very important. Mm-hmm. Money is a byproduct of the value that you add.
I love that. And you're always going to be paid based off of your value. So do not underestimate your value, because that's going to determine, you know, if you hit that $100,000 or if you hit that million, $10 million mark.
The most important thing we want you to get from this video is the fact that you need to create a business. A business will be what allows you to create $100,000 annually without having to ask anyone for permission. Mm-hmm. Now, passive income is another important thing to your business, because once you do it, then the money just starts coming in, or it continues to come in without you having to work for it every single time.
Yes, we don't want you to go out and create a business that's full of active income where you are trading your time for money. Mm-hmm. We want you to create, like we said, that product that you can sell online that's going to allow you to have infinite amount of income that's coming into you, because you're not capping yourself. So the foundation that we just laid with you today is sharing, you know, what can you do to get started today so that you can scale to 100,000 to a million and beyond.
Right. And a very important component to that is passive income. And if you want different ideas on how to generate passive income, then check out our next video where we give you passive income ideas.
And make sure you click on the freebie below where you can learn 52 ways to flip money for infinite banking.
Remember to own your own lifestyle,
or someone else will.